Father everlast, the all-creating one, God Almighty. Through your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior.
the Christmas tree.
When we get to have all the food.
Getting Christmas presents.
Getting out my room, peeking the corner, and seeing where Santa Claus is.
What's your least favorite part?
Last year, the tree was fake and we could see right through it.
My brother cried because he's scared of Santa, but I'm not.
What kinds of things do you like to do in the snow?
Play in the snow.
I like to make snowmen. Make snow angels.
Like sandhills.
Snow fights.
And then I like to skate, but it's really hard. I can't even do it.
Whose birthday is on Christmas?
Jesus.
Jesus.
Jesus is.
Santa's. I mean, Jesus.
And where was Jesus born?
In a tent. In a stable. At a hospital.
In Bethlehem.
In Oklahoma.
Sheep and cow horses. Chickens.
Camels. Pigs. Elephants.
Bunnies and raccoons. Zebras.
Dogs and kitties.
Why do other people get presents on Jesus' birthday?
Because they've been good.
Well, they gave presents to him when he was born, and we give gifts to each other.
Because Jesus was the gift from God.
What do you think is Jesus' favorite part of Christmas?
Just seeing people happy.
See how everyone's being kind to one another.
Probably the missions for other homeless people.
If you could give Jesus a present, what would you give him?
A puppy dog.
A snowball.
A little bear, and he loves it.
I'll give him many toys.
My love. My heart. Everything I had.
Why do you think Jesus came to live with us?
Because he loves everybody the most.
Because he wanted us to be good, not bad.
God's son, and that was what God wanted him to do.
And that way he could fix out all the problems that we're having.
He felt like we were more important than him. I think he loves us very much.
Why is Christmas so special?
Jesus was born on that day.
Because you share it with your friends and family.
It's a day where we can spend time and we get to give presents to people without sharing. We get to praise it on Jesus.
I love it.
Merry Christmas, everybody.
Bye.
my job for so many years is this. Nothing so great should be easy. And that's where I come in. I'm Christmas Chaos. We've never met, but you know my work. I'm the unseen but ever-present force that stuffs your stockings full of stress and decks your halls with anxiety.
Thanks be to God, who always leads us in triumphal procession in Christ, and who makes known through us the fragrance that consists of the knowledge of Him in every place. 2 Corinthians 2:14.
Thank you.
Where is God in the silence? Where is God in the darkness? Could it be that your pain, your grief, all the world's suffering, all the world's darkness is the genesis of new life? For out of the darkness, when there was only emptiness, God spoke forth light. From within the darkness of the earth, toiling up from beneath the soil, God brought forth life. After that dark and stormy flood, adrift for 40 nights, from the hand of God came a promise. After the darkness of the wilderness, years wandering lost, trying to hold on to faith, he gave a promised land. From the darkness of a mother's womb, all the questions, all the expectation, God formed a child. And from the darkness of that silent night, when it seemed the voice of God was unheard, when it seemed the hand of God was unseen, that silence was broken by the cries of a baby, a son, a savior. God wastes nothing, not even our darkness. For we know that for those who love God, even in our times of darkness, God is working for our good. So today, in the midst of whatever darkness you feel, know this. Today, a light has dawned. Hope is not lost. Hope is never lost. Today, hope is born.
Praying.
loves to build stuff with his hands. Okay. I'm not technical, but here goes. And we saw this thing on a commercial, and it cut stuff. It's silver and shiny. And he said, that looks cool. It actually goes inside of the computer, but I'm not entirely sure about that. So that's what I need. One of those things that cuts. Micro processing chopinator. It had an ater in it. It has something to do with mom. Mom, mother, motherboard? Mother plate. Mother plate. Okay, on the commercial, it had a sound like a. Project for work, and I just want to get him something, you know, really special. Like I was saying, he loves building stuff. He's got his eye on this tree in the backyard. He's going to put a tree house for the kids. He is such a great dad. So, do you think you can help me with that?
I don't work here. Tell you what an incredible job you've done tonight. We're so proud of you. Really, so proud of you. The students have been prepping for months, and I know that many of them feel like this was their gift tonight to you, something of value they gave themselves. So we accept your gift, guys. That was just incredible. Gifts are a really big time at this time of year. As many of you know, I often have done no shopping as of this time every year. Well, this year is no different. I find myself at this point every year, and I always think, maybe I should have done something different. But you know what was harder this year than actually the stress of not having a single gift at my house? Was the stress of trying to compile a list of the things that I wanted for Christmas. Because everybody wanted a really specific, long list, colors, sizes, everything. So I just avoided all of the calls and the texts. I just really have no idea what to ask for. So I asked my friends, thinking I could just steal their ideas. One teacher said she wanted the cereal containers that they have at the hotels. The kind that you fill them up at the tap and then you turn the dial and it just comes all out. But her husband said that they take up too much space. Another teacher said she wanted a glass mixing bowl for her KitchenAid mixer. And I thought they came with a bowl that was stainless steel. So I asked her, you know, why would you need a glass one? And she said, well, it's obvious. I can see through it. So I could get that. Others asked for Wii games and purses, jewelries, a Fitbit. I asked the kids, and of course they wanted Xboxes and clothes and video games and cell phones. But I don't know, because honestly, those things fit nicely on a wish list. But I wonder if they're really the things that we want this Christmas. Really
we want most. Somewhere in the explosion of the internet, we went from surprise gifts that someone really thought up, somebody we love, to gifts that fit on wish lists. Ones we can click to buy. Ones that show up in fancy wrapping paper. Ones we barely even had to touch. They just somehow seem expected. Expectation is defined as a strong belief that something will happen, or a belief that someone will or should achieve something. The synonyms, the words that mean the same, assumptions, calculations, predictions. Is that what Christmas has become to us? A series of expectations? Some of them others impose on us, and some we just put on ourselves. Some are positive and fun, and others just really stress us out. We expect others to give us gifts and give us gift ideas, and we say it's because we want to give them exactly what they want, but doesn't it really just make it easier for us to pick something? We expect beautiful Christmas cards to start arriving in our mailbox, but the thought of me getting 7 people together and happy at the same time enclosed and matched just stressed me out. Other people probably expect you to juggle all the sides of the relatives and somehow magically manage to have a meal with every single one of them. Last I checked, there's only 3 meals in a day, but some of you guys told me that you were going to 4 Thanksgiving dinners at Carloop. So I know it's true. We expect our kids are going to get along, and somehow we're going to be super moms and super dads. We expect our spouse to put up lights on our house. We expect our decorated tree is somehow going to look like a magazine. Expectations. But then I looked up the antonym, the opposite of expectation. And the very first word was surprise. The unexpected comes as a surprise. What if our Christmas this year was about the surprise? Not about what we expect others to achieve, and not about what we expect ourselves to achieve. God invented Christmas, and God is surely all about the surprise. He's all about the unexpected. God regularly shows up in the unexpected places. From the very beginning, God showed up where he wasn't expected. In the Old Testament, he came to Abraham and told him that he and his wife would have a baby far past when that should actually be possible. He stood with Daniel in a den of lions. He was with Noah as he built a boat for a world that had never even seen rain. In the New Testament, he found Zacchaeus in a tree. He ate dinners with tax collectors. And he was in a room with a prostitute as she washed his feet with her tears. He sometimes showed up in dreams. He showed up in a burning bush. And sometimes just in a quiet whisper. At that first Christmas, Jesus showed up in the filth. The Savior of the world, the God of the universe, showed up among the animals in a barn. My God, our God, is not a God of the expected. I would have expected trumpets, red carpets, a throne, a palace, a worldly kingdom. Instead, he surprised us. Because the King of the world doesn't need a palace of worldly making. He built the world. It's him who's preparing the palace. So he showed up here where we would least expect it. Our God loves surprises. God has sometimes shown up in my own life where it was unexpected. Sometimes even when you expect his presence, you're surprised by his entry. Most of you know I was in Guatemala this fall with a missions trip. And we were holding dental and medical clinics. Many of our bags got delayed in customs. After a couple of days and lots of prayers from our students, we were given the necessary paperwork, we thought, to retrieve those final bags at the airport. So Rudy, our Guatemalan leader, and one of our medical leaders, Donna, and myself, were designated the three who would go retrieve them from the airport, and the airport is at least 6 hours away. So normally we didn't actually travel in the dark. It's not as safe. There's not street signs and road lights. Generally, we just drove during the day, and we always got back to the hotel before it got dark. But this day, we knew that it would be different. So we had to leave really early, because we needed to get there, we needed to do whatever we needed to do, and to get back all in one day. So we thought some things could happen. We thought maybe our papers might not be enough. We thought we might not have enough cash if we needed it. They might charge a tax, and we weren't really sure if we could pull enough money together. We weren't sure if it would just take too long. We didn't know how long this would last. Could we get there and negotiate and get back? So 100 scenarios were going through our mind, but before we left that day, we just prayed together. And we just said, Lord, whatever you want us to accomplish, you do it today. So we decided we could either use the medicines there, or we could use the power of his name. Either one would be fine. We just asked for peace on the journey. We weren't 15 minutes down the road, just talking about life, Donna and Rudy and I, enjoying time together. Still driving in almost complete darkness, down a highway when all of a sudden, we realized an entire tree had fallen across the road. It was much like when there's a hurricane here and the trees just unroot themselves and fall over. The same had happened. There had been a storm the night before. It was the rainy season. And the tree just fell on the road. And just the moment we saw the tree in this two-lane highway, we realized a semi-truck was coming in the other lane. So truck or tree. In my wildest imagination, running every scenario I could have possibly imagined, I never would have come up with a scenario. To make matters worse, I wasn't wearing a seatbelt. I know, an incredibly poor choice. I can't even think of a time in my entire life that I haven't worn a seatbelt. But we had been in a bus for most of the week, and so I hopped in the back of the van and didn't even think about it. So there we are. Students, don't ever follow that example. Always wear a seatbelt.
Don't worry, I'm not
headed to. So semi or tree. Rudy picked a tree. And we slammed right into it. The van had all the damage to prove it. But what started as a huge tree somehow broke apart and disappeared before our very eyes. And the car, with tons of damage, continued to drive. Not only was the van somehow still able to drive all the way to get our bags, the three of us were just fine. And I don't mean banged up, but fine. I know many of you have been in small car accidents, and somehow even those small accidents can provide big injuries. I mean, the three of us, one with no seatbelt, didn't even move from our seat. We were perfectly fine, no scratches. When by all rights, the tree should have won. I expected him in the medicine. I expected him in the hands of the dentist. I even expected him at customs, and I expected him in villages. I didn't expect him to move a tree. Where do you least expect him? Where do you not expect him to show up? In your secret hurt? In your crumbling marriage? In your distant relationship with your child? Do you think you won't see him in a glance from a friend, in a card from your parent? Maybe you didn't expect him here tonight. Maybe you thought you were coming to watch some great kids sing some Christmas songs. You didn't expect to feel him here, in this room, in your heart. Perhaps this is your unexpected place. God shows up where it's unexpected, but he also shows up when it's unexpected. In John 11, the Bible tells of how Jesus raised up Lazarus from the dead after he had been dead for 4 days. Every person around him thought it was too late, but Jesus is never too late. He just has unexpected, perfect timing. So instead of healing him like he had done in other times, He went to his gravesite and gave him life. Saul in Acts 9 got a letter from the religious leaders giving him permission to arrest every Christian and bring them to Jerusalem. On the way to round up those people, God showed up with a light so blinding and a message so clear that Saul's very name was changed to Paul to reflect the extreme change in his life. He went on to write much of the New Testament, and he spread the word of God further than anyone had before. This happens in our own life, too. On that day in Guatemala that the tree was moved for me, my husband also had his own timing story. Medical clinic on that day was done at a school that was finishing construction. The stairs and even the top floor didn't have railings yet. So he was carrying things up the stairs, and he fell off onto concrete, onto his back. The only thing different about this day was that I wasn't there. Every other day, we went to clinic together. So every other day, I carried his backpack while he unloaded the things. But that day, I wasn't there. So he landed on his back, on concrete, but with his backpack on. God has unexpected, but perfect timing. I'm sure Joseph, who became Mary's husband, didn't intend to pick a bride, get engaged, and then find her pregnant. That first year, the timing must have seemed so hard. But what about in the third year, when his toddler would have run to him? Or the 10th year, as he began to show Jesus his skills as a carpenter? Would the timing then have been worth it? Because unexpected surprises can turn out to be the most miraculous of gifts. God shows up in the unexpected places, at the unexpected times, to unsuspecting people. Mary didn't expect God to show up to her. Engaged but not married, a virgin, a teenager, not with the message that she would carry and raise the child of God. She certainly would have been unsuspecting. I have no idea why he chose Mary, but I suspect it had everything to do with her acceptance of that gift. Unexpected for sure. But I would imagine for every painfully hard moment, every horrible stare at the unmarried, pregnant, teenage girl, every whispered comment, every rude word, there must have been 100 moments with her eyes locked into Jesus' very eyes, as she rocked him, as she sang to him. She would have never expected it, but I suspect she wouldn't change that surprise for the world. Does it surprise you that over and over and over, God picked unsuspecting, ordinary people to walk among? Every disciple was just an ordinary guy. All of the people Jesus ate dinner with were just ordinary. Jesus was born to an ordinary girl. Mary wasn't the richest. She wasn't the loveliest, not more unique, richest, smartest. God loves the ordinary because that isn't at all what he sees. What we call ordinary, he called his greatest creation. What makes your own child so special in your eyes? What do you think when you look at them? When I say their name? They are generally the smartest or the fastest or the best behaved. They don't accomplish more or deserve more of our love. We just love them as average, ordinary kids because they're ours. The same is true for God. He comes to the ordinary because you are anything other than ordinary in his eyes. Love never sees ordinary. Love sees extraordinary. God shows up on earth all the time. He showed up in a physical body that first Christmas, and he continues to show up in the unexpected places at the unexpected times to unsuspecting people. And maybe for some of you, you're uncomfortable with the unexpected. You don't know how to plan for that. You like lists and check marks. You prefer wish lists and schedules. Some of you need to hear that there is still hope. You've stopped expecting anything. Your expectations were never met. You've been let down. Christmas time holds a great deal of pain. This time of year is just taken from you. It's saddened you. So you stopped expecting. But that's okay. Because my God, our God, He brings the unexpected. Just when you may not know how to hang on for one more day, one more hour, when you don't know how to pay the bills, when you don't know what comes next, when you feel alone and scared and left, when your deepest fears still remain behind the thickest of walls, in that moment, in this moment, He shows up, perhaps unexpectedly, with the greatest gift. Not wrapped in fancy wrapping, no gift bags, no ribbon bows. He came unexpectedly in a barn with the animals among the ordinary, wrapped in rags. God's greatest gift to you is Jesus. Jesus came for one reason alone, because of His unexplainable love for you. John 3:16 is one of the most quoted verses of all time. For God so loved the world, He gave His only Son, that whoever believes in Him will not perish but will have eternal life. He so loved the world. He so loves you. But let's not forget verse 17. For God did not send the Son into the world to judge the world, but that the world might be saved through Him. He doesn't ask you to be anything you're not. He doesn't ask you to change first. However you feel, however you are, Christ came for you. He came to an unsuspecting world for an unsuspecting moment like this very one. Not to judge, no pointed fingers, just love. Love that desires to save you right where you are. Ecclesiastes 7:20 says, there is not one totally good person on earth, not one who is truly pure and sinless. It says we all sin, no matter how hard we try, all of us. We're just sinners. But Romans 6:22 and 23 says, but now that you've found out, you don't have to listen to sin tell you what to do and have discovered the delight of listening to God telling you. What is the prize? A whole, healed, put together life right now with more and more of life on the way. Work hard for sin your whole life and your pension is death, but God's gift is real life, eternal life, delivered by Jesus our Master. That's your surprise. A whole, healed, put together life right now. Don't miss it. Those weren't my words. Those were Jesus's. Those are God's word for you. Maybe you've heard this message before, but just weren't sure what to do with it. Maybe you really weren't sure you believed it. Maybe you've never even heard what Christmas is actually about. I can't let you leave here tonight without allowing you to open His gift to you. I know it might look surprising, unexpected. This might not be what you came here looking for tonight. But He loves you. He has always loved you. He wants you to feel that tonight. He wants you to receive that. He won't force you. He's just inviting you. I'm going to pray now, and tonight, as I pray, if you want to receive His gift of love, you say the words in your heart as I say them aloud. And then our students are going to come and share one last song. But don't leave here tonight alone. Accept His love. Accept His gift. And then come tell us. Find a teacher, find myself, a staff member, any of us. We just want to know. We want to share in your joy this Christmas. Pray with me. Father God, I didn't come here expecting you tonight. I was unsuspecting. This is unsuspected. But I know I've tried everything else. And I realize now, you're what's been missing. I realize I sin. I do things that are wrong. Those things are what keeps me separated from you. I choose to accept your gift of Jesus, who was the perfect sacrifice for my sin. Come into my life and fill the empty places. Thank you, Jesus. stay. We're gonna all. I'm gonna get them all together so you can take pictures. Leave your seats for pictures, and then we'll all stay for refreshments if you would join us. Thank you so much for coming tonight, students. If you're on stage, please scoot to the middle. Middle is the mic. No, just this way. Students, look at me. Now you all need to make sure that you've smooshed in. Take a picture.